Welcome back to the Federal Executive Forum on Federal News Network. We're talking about emergency communications and public safety, very important program here, very timely, I might add. We're just getting ready to start talking about lessons learned. And Lori, I'm going to start with you. You've been at this program for quite some time. 9/11's been around for a while. What are the lessons learned that you're gleaming out there that you'd like to impart to the audience here?
I think one lesson that we've learned over and over again is that the most valuable, the most precious resource are the people, the telecommunicators who answer the 911 calls. We've really learned that in the last year. The pressure that those folks are under on a day-to-day basis and what they will continue to experience as they not only hear 911 calls but see them, that'll be an important issue to address. You know, we have data that shows that up to 25% of telecommunicators actually suffer from some form of PTSD. So addressing those things now, as the multimedia is being incorporated into their process, becomes really important. We developed a resource for those folks called NG911 or Next Generation 911 for telecommunicators, because there's an awful lot of misconception out there and anxiety about how the technology will change their jobs. In some ways, it'll help, you know. So that publication was written by them, for them, and we just want to make sure that their needs are being addressed.
Very important topic, very important subject, very important to point out that when these programs are needed the most is when the stress is high, the anxiety is high. These things need to work. They need to be simple. Wade, how about at the IPAWS program? What's the lessons learned that you're gleaming that you'd like to communicate with the community here?
Yeah, I'm going to lean right in on people with Lori. You know, we are just past 10 years since the IPAWS system became operational. And when we kind of redid the program office to start that off, we're all engineers. And I think when I look at around the screen here, most of the folks on here, we talk about communications, we're systems people, right? I think very important is to lean in on making sure that those systems fit with the people on the front end, those operators, it has to support the way they do business. And then for us on the back end, really, how is that message getting through that private sector infrastructure and being displayed to the people that we're trying to get to move, to do something or to take shelter? So really, I think not just engagement on the front end where, you know, in our systems training, you do your requirements development and you bring in your operator, then you build something and then you throw it out to them. Really, that engagement continually and throughout, I think is a big lesson for us, is that we need to have those operators in our development cycle the whole way through. And then I can't bring the public in necessarily, but at least people that really understand or are on the leading edge of how do you get people to change their behavior by sending them a text message. So that's a big lessons learned for us and the piece that we're leaning into really harvest here in the next year or so.
All about the people, that customer experience, if you will, right? The capability's got to be there and it's got to be easy to use in those kind of stressful situations. No question about it. Billy Bob Brown, how about from your perspective, lessons learned that you're discovering there?
Sure. I'd like to lean in as well on the people issue, but from just a slightly different perspective, in that it takes people to partner. That, as we're trying to build, a partnership across the nation to improve the ability of emergency communications to support operators, you know, one of the lessons that we've learned as we've been watching in this fiscally constrained environment that we're in, seeing challenges all across the nation, certainly at the state, local, territorial, tribal levels, you know, as well as the federal government and the various agencies, you know, as we look at, you know, the expansion of the Internet of Things and the availability for us to have connected devices that provide insights and that can improve some of our day-to-day lives, the way that we perform our operations as well. You know, the increased necessity for partnerships to get after some spectral efficiencies and funding challenges where we can find that that sharing of communication systems infrastructure, you know, really becomes the height of partnering. And that's what we've learned just most recently over this this past year in the federal space with our Emergency Communications Preparedness Center that includes 14 departments and agencies all working together to improve emergency communications for those responders at the federal level. We've seen federal agencies that have been working in partnership with each other, in partnership with state and locals to share infrastructure, to share spectrum, to ensure that that in a combined fashion, we can take advantage of infrastructure that that allows us to move together faster. Because, you know, truly, we are able to solve problems faster when we work together.
Very good point. Very good catch there. And again, the stitching it all together, and that's where this interoperability, I think, really comes into play as well, along with the leverage. All right, well, we're going to wrap it up with this last question that we love to ask. And I'm going to start with you, Marcus, at Panasonic, in regards to tell us what it looks like in a couple of years. Well, and not so much what's in the petri dish there at Panasonic Labs, but you know, perhaps the something that we can expect to start to see in the next 2 to 3 years to continue to address this very important topic.
Yeah, absolutely. And we're certainly not alone in this, but we're hoping to lead the charge in our vector of the industry. And that is partnering with our end users and clients to ensure that we are doing everything we can with them to prepare for 5G implementation. And we have found that those discussions need to be had so that they know what they can do to build out the infrastructure and make preparations to get the most out of 5G when it is fully deployed. And as the director said, the expansion of the IoT, the Internet of Things, and the need to focus on the expanding cybersecurity issues that go with that are conversations that we're having now, so that we are all prepared as a group to get the most out of 5G and use it to the best of our ability and smartly.
Really do appreciate everything that you all are doing to help bolster this ecosystem. Mornay, how about over at CommScope? What's it looking like in a couple of 3 years for you all there in regards to capability, new capability?
I think we're very excited about this whole first responder 5G coverage as we bring it along at the larger scale and bringing this private public networks together, and then really leveraging on 5G. Everybody's talking about 5G, but low latency applications. I think that's really where the next frontier is, where we're going to leverage digital resources across a much broader spectrum, take a forward deployment field hospital, where you now could have access to robotic surgery and a limitless supply of digital surgeons across the globe help you with that. Medical records, on an instance, you can have all the medical records available any part of the world. So those kind of low latency applications, I think, is really what's going to change the game for us in the future.
Right. And very important to understand this 5G capability once it's fully rolled out, how comprehensive of a capability that's going to be put into everybody's hands, so to speak. And I'm sure the federal folks here are thinking all about that. Nicholas, you're right in the middle of this 5G. What's it going to look like in 2 to 3 years, whether it's 5G or whatever else Verizon has in the hopper to roll out? Tell us what that's going to look like in about 3 years.
Yeah, I think the best way to understand where the future is what are we testing today? And to look at the test beds that are popping up across the country and our partnership with public sector, with public safety specifically, is really showing us where we're going. And one of those I'll highlight is Stafford County, Virginia, and their 5G test bed. So we're working with them on 5G enabled drones, as well as intelligent video over a drone. So getting live video surveillance or live video over a relief effort or recovery effort through that drone, and they cover 95. And so if there's an accident, they'd love to be able to send a drone out there to see it before an officer or an EMT can actually get out there, get eyes on scene quicker. And 5G allows for that, especially with the computer vision that's built into the intelligent video platform. And then the other side of the country I'll mention is Marine Corps Base Miramar. And the work that they're doing on their 5G living lab on a Marine Corps base to understand exactly how the Marine Corps could leverage 5G And if you didn't see the news recently in the last few weeks, Verizon rolled out a pretty cool new vehicle out there called Thor, Tactical Humanitarian Operations Response Vehicle. And that is a massive truck that's basically a 5G network on wheels that's automated, that's able to be deployed from a tablet and sets up a 5G coverage bubble. And what we've worked with them on is some relief efforts and some efforts on better situational awareness tools coming out of that 5G bubble. So those two sides of the country, I think, are really interesting test beds that'll show where we're going over the next couple of years.
Interesting and fascinating, and we really appreciate all the hard work there. Lori, how about at the 911 program? If I'm, you know, for all of us, we're always interested in thinking about the enhancements that are going to happen with the 911 program. What are we typically going to see in about 3 years?
We're seeing more and more 911 centers have the capability once they move to that next generation of 911 that's digital and based on an internet model to be able to transfer calls, you know, so that in the event of a large incident, calls don't get, remain unanswered. Mm. They'll be able to transfer them to another 911 center who isn't overloaded. Or in the case of a natural or man-made disaster, that's another incident where it'll become really important to be able to transfer calls. That's not possible now. But once 911 centers become incorporated into that new model, that resilience is built into it. So we're seeing more and more 911 centers be able to do that. I think the second thing goes back to what I talked about before in terms of the interconnection of the entire emergency communications ecosystem. I think we're going to begin to see examples where 911 will receive, for example, a photograph of a suspect, mm-hmm. and will be able to get that photograph out to the patrol car. So I think those two things show enormous promise, and we'll probably start to see that within the next couple of or 2-3 years.
So if I have a call and I'm whether it's a wreck or a situation, I can snap a photograph, send it to the 911 center, and then they can get it out to the cruiser on the scene, so to speak.
Yeah, assuming that that NG911 structure is in place and assuming mm-hmm. that all the pieces are connected, that right. will.
Can I text a 911 center now?
I'd say about half of the 6,000 or 7,000 911 centers can receive text messages now. Okay. There is a map on the FCC's website. They actually collect information with regard to 911 centers that are ready to receive text messages. So that would probably be the most reliable source of that information.
All right.
It's dependent on funding and, you know, governance kinds of issues.
Sure. Well, that's good. And that's good to know that there's a place that the public can go and keep an eye on when that's going to happen in their jurisdiction, so to speak. Wade, how about at the IPAWS program? It looks like you've got a pretty good handle on being able to get the messages out to the phones. I certainly get plenty of them. My colleagues, friends, and family do as well. What can we expect in a couple of years from now? We're going to get full motion video out of you guys. What's going to happen?
Yeah, we'll keep our fingers crossed. I think that's very doable. I'd say one way to roll part of our vision into three letters is AOE. So really we're pursuing alerts on everything. And the private sector, our partners, the folks on this call here are leaning in to put the systems in place to make that a reality. And that's a big deal for us. I think also really we want to make EAS new again to include helping our AOE vision. We have, you know, there's a new digital TV coming. It's deployed in a few stations around the country. The AWARN Alliance actually put the core information standard, the Common Alert Protocol that all alerts that move through IPAWS are in. That's in the industry standard for that new TV, digital TV platform that's coming. And I think that and really rolling into, we're getting some assistance again from Congress prompted, and the FCC is leaning into all the streaming services. So as people migrate their attention to different things or they're consuming content via different means, the ability to make sure that emergency information when it needs to get there mm-hmm. to those people, no matter what they're paying attention to.
Right. So if you've got an individual that's on a laptop and is watching Amazon Prime or whatever, you're going to be able to tap into that capability as well and blast a message into there. Mm-hmm. Super important, right? As everyone's sort of dealing with these omni-channel environments that they're operating in on basically a daily basis. Billy Bob Brown, tell us what it's going to look like in a couple of years there. You're kind of sitting on the top of this, trying to pull all this together, you and your organization over there. What's it look like in 2 to 3 years?
Thanks. The interesting component that I see as we look forward into the future is how voice, video, data, and information services on behalf of operators that are providing for the safety of our citizens is pulled together through the entirety of the emergency communications ecosystem. As Lori talked about, you know, text and multimedia to 911, as Wade talked about, you know, having the ability for multimedia to eventually be pushed out through alerts and warnings to, you know, give, you know, granular kinds of information to citizens to help them understand what the other threat and the challenges are. You know, what we want to help make sure that that we're looking at all of this advancement into the all IP and connected environment recognizes is risks and challenges that that faces today. You know, a few years ago when we were talking about challenges for emergency communications and public safety, we were really only talking about, you know, focusing on trying to do effective and integrated partnering and planning against, you know, challenges that were reflected in, you know, destructive and disruptive weather, accidents and challenges that cause congestion and the need for priority access for our first responders. However, today, you know, we recognize that there's thinking challenges, you know, criminality all across the world that's organized and even nation state considerations, you know, force us to think more broadly and understand that the emergency communications ecosystem has challenges. What if there were malware embedded in that multimedia that was sent to 911 that eventually went to the cruiser that was eventually sent out as part of a an alert or warning that now potentially has challenges that infect large numbers of emergency communications systems across a large area, and if that was pre-planned, you know. So the idea of, you know, looking at the risks that face all of our national critical functions and understanding those challenges in the all IP environment and the cybersecurity challenges that pose our connected emergency communication systems is what we see in the future as we move towards, you know, more of a partnering, more of a close collaborative working together amongst all of our communicators, whether they're information technologies specialists, whether they're communication spectrum specialists, whether they're wired infrastructure specialists or satellite specialists, all working together because we recognize that for the safety of the citizen, where those seconds count, we do have to work together faster in order to solve those problems to prevent that adaptive, dynamic, and active thinking threat from hampering and hindering and challenging and disrupting our emergency services as they're trying to provide for safety of citizens. And that's where we're going. That's where I see us working. That's where we're actively continuing to build partnerships. You know, just a little plug, CISA is hiring, www.cisa.gov. We are always looking to bring on new talent to help us continue to advance the security and the resilience across the nation against what we know are the risks that face us, which, you know, as I sort of articulated, you know, encompassed in this this thinking threat is one that really takes all of us working together. You know, that is why we are the United States. We are stronger together.
Really do appreciate that. And I'll put in an additional plug for all of you that have never tried public service. Give it a try because it tastes great. That's my punchline there. I want to thank all of the guests today for taking their time out of their busy schedules to join us on this program. So important for every American citizen to hear this. And we really do appreciate all of you together fighting the good fight to keep us all safe, quite frankly. I'd like to thank our sponsors for supporting us on the show. I'd like to thank the good people here at Federal News Network that make this program so successful and enjoyable. And most of all, I'd like to thank the listening audience out there that tune in every month. You're listening to the Federal Executive Forum on Federal News Network.